Paul says in verse 11 that it's the whole armor of God. It's the armor that God has provided us. So this indicates that we should not just put on part of the armor, not just put on part of the list, but we have to put on the whole armor of God. Well, what is this armor? Well, we can start in verse 13. It says here, "Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm." He begins verse 13 with "therefore." In other words, because we are fighting an enemy that is not flesh and blood, one that we cannot see, for this reason we have to take up the armor of God. Now, "take up" is a Greek word that is an imperative. It's like a military command. Take up the armor of God. This is something that there's an urgency to it. Well, why is there an urgency to it? He tells us why. So that we'll be able to stand in the evil day. Folks, if you've had a charmed life, if you've had a life that just everything has gone well, trust me, there comes a time that there's going to be an evil day. There comes a time there's going to be an evil day. The scripture says that God causes the rain to fall on the just and the unjust. So there's days of blessing and there's days that are evil. There's days that are hard. There's bad things that happen to good people. And it's too late to do something about that evil day when the evil day has come. And so what he's saying here is, take up the whole armor of God. When? When you see the day coming? No. Every day we take up the whole armor of God. This is an imperative. We take up the whole armor of God. It's critical to do it now, that you may be able to stand in the evil day. Well, what are we to put on? Well, we're to put on the whole armor of God. God has provided, and we're going to go through it, God has provided a lot of weapons, and he wants us to put on the whole armor of God. Now, that means there's a list. Whenever you come across a list, that's an opportunity for you to look and say, what do I have right and what do I need to work on, right? Well, that's what we want to go through. Why put on the whole armor of God? Because if you leave off a piece of the armor of God, then you are vulnerable. It's kind of like Achilles was armored very well, was he not? But there was one place where he wasn't armored. You remember the story, right? Those of you that have studied Greek mythology. He wasn't armored on his heel, and that left him vulnerable. Well, okay, so this word for whole armor is panoplia. In other words, there's a whole spectrum of weapons that God has made for us, and every one of them has their part. And I've entitled this passage Practical Spiritual Warfare, because I think that these weapons are all practical. They all play a part. And we need to focus on every single one of them. We can't do this like a cafeteria style. Well, I'll have one of those, and I'll have one of those, and I'll have one of those. No, take up the whole armor of God, right? That's what he says here. All right, so let's dig in. The first one in the first part of verse 14 says, "Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth." Stand therefore. Stand firm, and stand is a recurring theme in this. We're fighting a holding action. Satan is attacking us and we are trying to stand firm. This is a picture of what the victorious Christian is supposed to be. A lot of times we our Christian walk is kind of like a roller coaster, right? I have these highs and that's great, but I have these lows too. That's not the way God has ordained it. He wants us to be able to stand firm. He wants us, yeah, we're going to have some lows and highs, but he wants us to grow strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. So he starts off with the belt of truth. Stand, having girded yourself with truth. This is not the passive voice here. This is an action. It's something that we are responsible for. Well, what's he talking about? Well, the belt was foundational. And we're going to go through it, the metaphors here are all, I'm sure, around the Roman soldier, because in this day the Roman soldier was everywhere, and so people would think of that soldier when he's talking about armor and so forth. Well, the belt was foundational and it served a couple of purposes. One purpose was that you bound up your flowing robes when you went into battle so that you wouldn't trip. And so it was to gird up your loins, the scripture says in other places. But it was not just foundational in that sense. It was also important for doing two things. Number one, we're going to talk about the breastplate. The belt held the breastplate down. You can think about being in battle, and you think about, you know, a very active scene. That breastplate comes up and whacks you in the face, and it's not going to do a whole lot of good. The belt held the breastplate in place. It was also foundational in that it held the sword up. And in its sheath, the belt was what held the sword up. So it was very purposeful. So he would be saying here that truth is very important. Why truth? Well, one reason is Jesus' truth. John 14, 6 says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus' truth. And I've made this point before, but it's an important point to keep making because we really do live in a post-truth world. God despises twisting of the truth. God is all about truth. He is the only one that's all about truth. He says in Isaiah 5, 20, woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. We are in a post-truth world. No one prizes truth today. No one prizes truth. They're not trying to get across the truth. They're trying to win an argument. And so if truth doesn't suit me very well, then I'll just use falsehood instead of truth. You see it. You see it everywhere. Our consumer, on the consumer side, society tends towards confirmation bias. I'm not interested in the truth. I'm interested in you telling me something that confirms the bias that I already have. You know what I mean by confirmation bias? I don't like that particular guy, so if you say something bad about him, it doesn't matter whether it's truth or not. I agree with you. That's confirmation bias, and it's running rampant through our society. I've told you this before, I know, but social media is not our friend. It's our enemy. I truly believe that it's our enemy. I mean, I use it. I do. I've got an account, and I look at people's pictures, and if they say something clever or funny, I like it. But it's a very poor place to get your information, and the reason is very simple: lies travel much, much faster on social media than truth does. It's been proven. They've done research on it. Why? How does that happen? Well, here's why: because the artificial intelligence that is trying to figure out what it's going to show you on your Facebook page wants two things out of you. It wants to keep you on Facebook, and it wants to see how many things you'll click on. And they have found out that the things that inflame you the most are the things that will keep you on there reading it and the things that you will click on and share. It's not interested in truth. They call it a news feed. It's not a news feed. It's a lie feed. In fact, if you want to know the truth, you're much more likely to be getting fed lies than you are the truth, because lies spread faster than truth. This is an abomination to God, and it's not something that the Christian should support. In Isaiah's lament in chapter 59 about the condition of Israel, God has him write this: justice is turned back and righteousness stands far away, for truth has stumbled in the public squares and uprightness cannot enter. Truth is lacking, and he who departs from evil makes himself a prey. The Lord saw it and it displeased him that there was no justice. That's a sad lament, but is it not descriptive of our society today and our situation around the world? Truth has indeed stumbled in the public square. Politicians don't tell the truth, generally speaking. They tell what they think you want to hear. Well, okay. So we should not, as Christians, be that way. We need to make truth our banner. Truth needs to be what defines us. The hallmark of a Christian, and hear this, I don't care what political party you affiliate with. I don't care. But the hallmark of a Christian should not be political party or social affiliation or anything else. Truth should be our banner. Jesus said when he was praying for his disciples right before he went to the cross, one of the things he prayed to the Father is sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. This should be the lens through which we look at everything. And if something that you say agrees with my political bias, but it's not true, I should not accept it. I should not accept it. The truth should be our banner. How do we make the truth our banner in a practical way? Well, we just don't accept things that are not the truth. If I find out something that is the truth and it conflicts with some bias that I have, then I need to change my bias. Do I not? I need to look at that thing that's truth and say, well, that's the truth. I've got to somehow make the way I believe conform to that because that's the truth. We need to be more interested in the truth as believers than we are any other issue because Jesus is the truth. Okay, well, let's move on. We got to get, how much time do I have? 4 hours? Perfect. Perfect. I think I can get through it in 4 hours. By the way, those of you that have young people that were down at the beach, they have headed this way. I know because I got a telephone call right before I was supposed to come up, and they couldn't figure out how to lock the door. So, okay, the second part of verse 14. So, fasten the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, the breastplate of righteousness. You know, we are really blessed, I think you will all agree, that God imputes the righteousness of Christ to us. Amen? I mean, the fact that I don't have to stand on my own and say, okay, God, put me in the balance whether I'm good enough to get into your heaven or not, because I'm not. But God says, because of what Christ did, I impute his righteousness to you. That's a blessing. That's not what we're talking about here. That's not what we're talking about here because I can't put on Christ's righteousness. That's something that God imputes to me is Christ's righteousness. This is talking about the sanctifying work of the Holy Spirit in my life. This is me conforming my life to Christ, growing in righteousness. Now, this is not righteousness that I can stand before God, right? It doesn't matter how good I get. My righteousness is as dirty rags as far as getting into heaven. But this is practical righteousness, good living, right living, and it's a breastplate. It's a breastplate. How does righteousness relate to the breastplate? Well, the breastplate protects all the vital organs against the enemy's weapons, sword, dagger, even arrows to some degree. Our enemy, the devil, accuses us day and night before God, Revelation 12:10. And unfortunately, a lot of times I give him good ammo for accusing me before God. While this has no effect on God or our position with him because that's Christ's righteousness, it damages us, does it not? Maybe some of you have had this feeling before where you wanted to try to serve Christ in some way and you think to yourself, man, I'm not good enough to serve Christ in that way. Who am I to do that? Well, I can't do it on my own, but I can do it under the power of the Holy Spirit. You think about this, when I fail to make myself righteous, I'm talking about humanly terms. I'm talking about doing what the Scripture says. I'm talking about being conformed into the image of Christ. I'm talking about striving to be like Jesus to the extent that God allows me. I am continually assaulted if I fail to do that about my ability to stand for Christ. The devil has a foothold. The devil has a way to accuse me. When I do not act righteously, I also open the Lord up to disdain. When I denigrate people for their political beliefs, I alienate them from the message of the gospel. But when I make my stand in the integrity of the Lord in my business, for example, people take notice. People take notice that you're going to do the right thing. I had a boss one time that wanted me to meet with auditors and tell them a lie. And his boss said, Ray won't do that. And it was because I had taken a stand, and he knew that I would not do that. I would not tell that lie. If we take our stand and we try to live a righteous life, when I don't join in coarse jesting or sexual banter, the working of the Lord in my life is evident. People take notice. When I exercise discipline and restraint in physical pleasures, I magnify the spiritual side of my existence. When I put down those desires that are unhealthy, that are not part of God, when I strive to be like Christ in that way, then the spiritual part of my being becomes enhanced. I start becoming a little bit more like the spiritual being that God created in me. Righteous living is something that we are meant to do as believers. And you know what? This has fallen out of favor. I think that this is one of the places where we just said, once saved, always saved, a little bit too much. Right? Because we don't strive for righteous living if we have this idea that, well, I'm only human. I'll just 1 John 1:9 it, and then I'll be okay. That's not the life that God wants us to do. By putting on that breastplate of righteousness, we minimize the amount that the enemy can attack us in that way. So that's very practical. Then he goes on in verse 15. He says, "And as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace." Well, shoes shod with the gospel of peace, one other version calls it. When we are attacked by flesh and blood, our natural response is to do what? Strike back, right? When we're attacked, strike back. Sarcasm comes to my mind. I want to strike back. I want to win the argument. I want to do whatever. But what needs to happen is my first thoughts need to be about the gospel. I need to be ready with the gospel. Now, we think about the gospel. One of the things when you go through membership interviews here is we ask you, tell us the gospel. Tell us what you think the gospel is. And a lot of times we think about the gospel only in the context of salvation. But the gospel is good news, and it's good news for a lot of different reasons. The gospel is our response to the attacks by flesh and blood. The readiness or preparation of the gospel is actually foundational. It should pervade every bit of us. The Roman soldiers' feet, by the way, of course, they wore sandals. They didn't have boots. They wore sandals that were made of leather, and they had straps that held them onto their feet and maybe even wrapped all the way up their calves. But the interesting thing was the Roman soldiers' sandals on the bottom had nails protruding out of it. And the purpose for the nails, I kind of thought about it like, man, I remember when we had golf shoes that had spikes on them. I liked that because when you walk across concrete, it made a neat sound, you know. But these sandals had nails in them so that their feet were planted firmly in the ground, because a lot of times the armies, they didn't, you know, fight from a distance the way armies do today. They came up against each other. And so the sandals allowed them sure footing. And so that was foundational for them. The gospel is our answer to opposition in really virtually every aspect of our struggle. It's the gospel. When there's self-doubt, the gospel is what gives us strength. We preach the gospel to ourselves. If I'm doubting myself, that's okay. I need to preach the gospel to myself so that I don't doubt the Lord. Right? If I'm fighting spiritual powers, it's the gospel that demonstrates their defeat. It was the gospel that brought about the ultimate demise of these spiritual forces. Ultimately, they've been defeated. Did you know that? They've been defeated. They were defeated at the cross. They managed to kill the one that they knew was their greatest enemy, and they rejoiced over it. And then 3 days later, he rose from the dead, and they went, whoops. So it is the gospel that comes up against these spiritual forces. What about when I'm fighting flesh and blood? Well, that flesh and blood is not my enemy, even though it may be trying to hurt me. They're not my enemy. It's the gospel that I need to be preaching. You know, people that are in opposition to us, we need to be sharing the gospel. You know, a lot of times what we try to do is change people's behavior, right? They're doing something that's sinful. That's sinful. Stop it. And I always ask the question, does that get them any closer to heaven? If you could succeed in stopping them from doing that, would it get them one bit closer to heaven? Not a bit. Not a bit. It's only the gospel that has the power to get them closer to heaven. That's what they need, is the gospel. All right. So we need to have our feet shod with the gospel of peace. Let's move on. Verse 16 says, "In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. Now, this is really interesting. The ESV translates the start of this verse, in all circumstances, but the NASB, I think, is a little closer to the Greek. It says, in addition to all, in addition to all. Once again, we take up the whole armor of God. The shield of faith is not a, if I have a shield of faith, that doesn't mean I don't need the breastplate of righteousness, right? In addition to all, take up the shield of faith. It's not a substitute. And it's to be protected against the evil one. A person has to have faith to not succumb to Satan's temptations. Eve didn't have enough faith. How do I know that? Well, she didn't trust God enough. When Satan said to her, has God really said? God doesn't want you to be like him. So he tells her a falsehood. And she didn't have enough faith to know, you know what? I know God. I trust God. I trust his character. God wants only good things for me. That would have been the answer of faith. But she didn't have enough faith for that. And so she believed the lie. So the Greek word for shield here doesn't refer to the small buckler, the round shield that you see so many pictures of with Roman soldiers having. That's not this shield. This is the big shield. This is a shield that was 2.5 feet wide and 4 feet long. It was a big shield. And the purpose of this shield was when the armies were marching in formation and they're marching against a stronghold. What do they need protection from? Well, the first thing they need protection from is arrows. So they were able to take these shields and put them up, and it became a great floating roof over the whole army. So as these arrows would rain down on them, it wouldn't kill them. That was the purpose of this big shield. And the interesting thing that I read was that a lot of these shields, how do you defeat a wooden shield? Shoot arrows that are on fire, right? And so what they would do is they would dip their arrows in pitch and light them on fire, and they would shoot those, and shields would burn up. But the clever armies would take their wooden shields, and they would put a layer of leather over the wooden shield, and they would offset it a little bit from the wooden shield. You say, well, what does that do? Well, what that does is when a flaming arrow comes in and goes through the leather and sticks in the wood, that cavity between there runs out of oxygen and it puts out the flaming arrow. That's what he's talking about here. He's talking about that it will extinguish the flaming arrows of the evil one. Well, that's interesting. So the believer's faith defeats the fiery darts of the enemy. The fire cannot take hold because the faith that believes God rather than the lies of Satan. Resist the devil and he will flee from you, the scripture says. Your boss can't stand you and will not promote you. It's the faith that allows me to trust that maintaining the integrity of my heart will give me the ultimate reward. What is that ultimate reward? Is it a promotion at work? Or is it, well done, thou good and faithful servant? Enter into the joy of the Lord. That's the ultimate. You're diagnosed with a dreadful disease. It's the faith that allows you peace in trusting God, trusting in his power and his sovereign will and your ultimate position with him. It's faith. You see a way to undermine a colleague at work with just a little bit of backbiting or a little word to their enemy. But your trust in God that his way is better keeps you from doing that. That's faith. That's faith to say, you know what? This is what the scripture says. I'm going to trust that it's better. It's better. When Satan's flaming dart is a temptation to do evil, a temptation to sin in a way that brings you pleasure. But the scripture says that it's better not to do that. It's better to cut off the arm and cast it from you than to allow that temptation to do it. That's faith. It takes faith. The flaming darts of the evil one. You hear a rumor or something that spreads dissension within the community of faith. It takes faith to say, no, I will not listen to that. I will not listen to that. Or if it's true, then I will go address that with someone. That's part of our commitment that these folks that just joined the church have made. It takes faith. All right. Verse 17, the first part of verse 17, and take the helmet of salvation. The helmet of salvation. Well, the helmet is obviously a protective device, right? Covers my head keeps the head of the soldier here. But the salvation here, I think, and most commentators would not say this is salvation as in our salvation from our sins, because I don't take that on continually, right? That's once and for all. God has imputed Christ's righteousness, and therefore I am justified. That's not what this is talking about here. Here Paul is more referring to the assurance of salvation in the conflict. Our salvation, whether it be justification for our sins, or whether it be salvation from temptation, is from the Lord. The closer we draw to God, the more assurance we have that no matter what our circumstances, God is going to save us. He's going to preserve us. I think Paul refers to Isaiah 59 again here, and with the breastplate, God has lamented. We already read a passage where God has lamented about the condition of Israel and how poor the condition is. And finally, he does what he does so often in the Old Testament prophecies. He says, so I'm gonna get in here. And he says this in Isaiah 59, starting in verse 16. He says, he saw that there was no man and wondered that there was no one to intercede. Then his own arm brought him salvation, and his righteousness upheld him. He put on righteousness as a breastplate and a helmet of salvation on his head, and put on garments of vengeance for clothing, and wrapped himself in zeal as a cloak. He's talking about Christ here and how Christ has, and the way that Christ has arrayed himself. We need to do the same. And then he continues on in verse 17. The sword of the Spirit. Take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. The sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. The Roman short sword was ubiquitous. It was well known throughout the known world. It was a formidable weapon because it allowed him great mobility. He could use the short sword to parry a thrust of spear or sword, and he could also use it so as a defensive weapon. He could also use it as an offensive weapon. Parry and thrust. It was like I said, a very, very powerful weapon. So is the Word of God. So is the Word of God. It is your defense, and it is your weapon. And we need to make sure that we know it. It's defensive in that we can use it as a defense against the lofty attacks of the evil one. Paul writes this in a parallel passage in 2 Corinthians 10. He says, for though we walk in the flesh, we are not waging war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. We destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God, and take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. Here he's talking about doing battle in the war of words. And we don't try to argue people into heaven. We use the Word of God. People have lofty ideas. This has become a very common thing, and I've brought it up many times in sermons. The atheists of today are aggressive. They would like to tell you that you're stupid. Did you know that? Did you know that you're dumb for believing this stuff? That's what they would have you believe, and they have all kinds of arguments to tell you why that is the case. The answer to it is the Word of God. The Word of God is powerful. The Word of God is powerful for taking thoughts captive, for showing them the foolishness of their own arguments, and showing them how God has an answer for these real things. But we have to know the Word of God to do that. We have to know the Word of God to take those thoughts captive, to come up against those strongholds, to do battle in a place where we can't see our enemy. We have to know the Word of God. It's also a powerful weapon for bringing those people that are used as proxies to salvation. Somebody attacks me. They're not my enemy. I want to share the gospel with them. I want to use the Word of God. I want to use the Word of God. Paul says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation, for everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. I read a story about a woman who was a militant LGBTQ advocate, and she was militant in the sense that she despised Christians, and so she was going to take them on, show them how foolish they were. And there was a pastor and his wife that invited her to come over, and they didn't try to preach at her. They said, any questions you have, we'll answer. And over the course of the next year and a half, they met and they had dinner and they talked about her contentions about the Word of God, and she became a believer. The gospel has the power to change lives. And then he talks finally at the end about prayer. Prayer is not part of the armor of God, but it's nevertheless part of the weapon. Verse 18 and following, praying at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints, and also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. So prayer is not part of this paradigm of armor of God, but it's nonetheless crucial as part of our weaponry. It is absolutely crucial. Jesus stressed it. Jesus prayed all the time. Paul stresses it. And he says several important things about prayer here. First, he says, pray at all times. Be constant in prayer. It says that in Philippians as well. This brings us closer to God and puts us in touch with His will. When we are in prayer, when we're constantly in prayer, I find, for one thing, is I'm tempted to sin less, because prayer brings me closer to God, praying in all times and in all ways. He says, all prayer and supplication. So prayer is communing with God, and supplication is asking God for something, right? We're supposed to bring our requests to God. Well, what requests? Well, all sorts of requests. But unfortunately, a lot of times when we pray, we're just praying for things. That's not all of our supplication. We should be praying about things. We should be praying about struggles. Are you under attack now? Are you under attack from the evil one, from the powers and authorities and rulers? Pray. Pray. It brings us closer to God. It gives us power against the evil one. I'm convinced that one of the reasons it says all the time that Jesus was off praying, and I'm convinced that one of the reasons he was praying, here Paul says, pray for all the saints. Do you do that? Do you pray for saints? Do you ask God sometime to put a saint on your, a saint being another believer, all right? Not a perfect person, another believer. Put somebody on my heart and let me pray for them. If you can't think of anybody, pray for me. Jesus prayed all the time, and I'm convinced that one of the reasons he prayed all the time is because he had 12 men and 7 women that were following him around everywhere, and I bet he prayed for them every single time. Oh, dear God, the sons of thunder, please help them not to blow up, you know. And dear God, that Peter, oy vey, I don't even know how to pray for him. I think Jesus was praying for them all the time, and we need to do that. He's given us that mission, praying to God, supplicating God, asking God. We should be praying for peace. We should be praying for our leaders, even if you didn't vote for them. We should be praying for our government. Heaven knows it needs it. We should be praying for our church. Heaven knows it needs it. We should be praying at all times. Pray for the body. Pray for the mission of the church. Pray that the gospel message would be able to go out into these neighborhoods around here. Pray that people would drive by and see that sign and say, and I know you, some of you have this testimony, people would drive by and say that sign and say, you know what, I'm going to go in there. I'm going to see what they have to offer. I will ask the question again, how can we enter into a battle with an unseen enemy? How do we fight against an enemy that uses fleshly proxies without making the proxies our enemy? We can only do that by putting on the whole armor of God, using the tools that God has given us to use, and being the kind of people that God wants us to be. We can indeed be strong in the Lord and in the strength of His might. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord God, that you didn't just save us and then abandon us. We thank you, Lord God, that you didn't just leave us bare to the ways of the evil one. For Lord, he does want to hurt us. He does want to destroy us. If he can't destroy us as he couldn't destroy Job, he wants to make us ineffective. But Lord, we want to trust you. We want to believe you. We want to be strong in the strength of your might. Help us, Lord, as we consider these things, as we take on your armor, as we become the kind of soldiers that you want us to be in this cosmic fight that you've ordained for us. And we will always give you the praise and the glory. In Christ's name, amen.
Let's stand, church. Do you feel the world is broken?
We do.
Do you feel the shadows deepen?
We do.
But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all made new? As all creation groaning, it is a new creation coming, it is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst, it is it good that we remind ourselves of this? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's rune and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of our blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of this? He is. Does the Father truly love us?
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us? Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those he loves.
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us? He does. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and the grave? He is David's rune and the Lamb who died. His throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of Him who died for me.
Contemporaries, Peter wrote in his first letter, "Humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, so at the proper time He may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on Him, because He cares for you." Be sober-minded. Be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. Let's remember this morning that the word that Ray brought to us by the Holy Spirit was a practical word, and it reminds us that this is not, the walk of a Christian is not a spectator sport. Though we are not saved by works, we are saved by grace through faith. God gives us works to walk in and prepares beforehand those works. And we are to be active in our faith. That is how we should grow. So especially if you're here this morning, and if you are in a struggle, a deep struggle, understand there are spiritual realities behind it. This is not happening outside of the purview of God or the sovereignty of God. No matter where that struggle comes from, your own heart, your spouse, a friend, another family member, something completely outside, a health issue, no matter what it is, remember there are spiritual forces at work, and God is calling you to faithfulness. And Ray has shared with us a very practical teaching on how we are to engage in that day by day. Please remember that. If you need more confirmation in that, you know, we put these sermons online, so you can go and re-listen to them if you'd like to. So please do that if you must. This is a word for today and a practical word for all of us. Let me pray over us as we prepare to leave here. Father, we thank you. We thank you, Father, that you have shod our feet with a gospel of peace. And you reminded me, even as Ray preached, that that peace is peace between you and me. You have made peace with me, with everyone here who calls Jesus Christ Lord and Savior and has by faith believed on him and repented of their sins. You have taken care of our biggest problem, Father. Remind us of that this morning when we are embroiled in real problems, real challenges, real trials and suffering, real battles. Remind us this morning that they are subject to your sovereignty, and they are smaller and they are temporal. You have taken care of us eternally, Father. You will care for all of our temporal things as well, in your time and in your way. Cause us to walk by faith, to remember and to wait on your goodness. We love you, Father. Help us as we go from this place. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, you are all very loved. Have a wonderful day.